they don't like random food.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm sure, yeah.
Well, I wanted to test the link to make sure that it worked. And now it's throwing me to an authentication. I always test. It's okay, you have 4 more minutes, you can keep talking. Oh, maybe it does work. Got it. Steel in Vrag.
It works with silver light.
Yeah.
I'm not sure whether this is correct on your player.
Okay, so I feel confident enough I can tweet it out.
These are the voyages of the starship Enterprise. Its 5-year mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
alles wat ik hoor, vraag ik mijzelf af van, wie zegt dat? Is dat zo? Waarom denken we dat?
I think it is important to make school fun. And when school is fun, you don't get kids waking up in the morning and say, do I have to come to school again? So we embrace technology because it helps us make learning more engaging. I believe that when kids are engaged, when kids are interested, that's where learning takes place.
The kids are really from a very different world now. And really to reach out to the kids, you need to be savvy with technology. If you're not savvy with technology, you're going to lose the kids in the school.
The future will be more electronic, like everything will be more with the laptop.
We will not alles kunnen opladen. We moeten niet meer blokken, we kunnen gewoon uploaden on demand. Dat zou fantastisch zijn.
Wij denken dat binnenkort de handboeken zullen verdwijnen.
Dat er digitale leerkrachten zullen zijn.
Zoals bijvoorbeeld robots, omdat er ook mensen bijvoorbeeld geprojecteerd worden in de klas.
En dat er leerlingen vanuit thuis uit onderwijs zullen volgen.
Och, ik denk dat vooral de boeken vooral zullen verdwijnen en de creatborden zullen ook allemaal vervangen worden door de smartborden. Ik denk dat die evolutie dat we niet meer kunnen tegenwerken.
Onderzoek over technologiegebruik. En daar gaan we. Computer Assisted Instruction, punt 37. Nee, haalt de grens niet. Web-based learning. Je weet wel al die beloftes. Vanaf nu gebeurt alles online en we gaan het doen via ons leerplatform op school en zo. Sorry, punt 18. Er is dus duidelijk meer aan de hand. Hoe komt het dat we dus vaststellen dat eigenlijk de resultaten zo laag zijn? Waar past in feite die applicatie, waar past die in een leerlijn?
Ik denk dat we de medewerkers vooral centraal moeten zijn om die heel flexibel gaan moeten kunnen omgaan met verschillende media, verschillende manieren van werken.
En de moraal van het verhaal is niet aan.
Hier regeert de mobiel in de pauze, maar ook vaak in de les. De smartphone, je vrienden altijd bereikbaar. Het is o zo verslavend.
Niemand slaapt meer.
Niemand slaapt meer?
Nee. Ja, iedereen is gewoon online. Altijd non-stop bereikbaar. We leven in principe gewoon in een chatsessie, non-stop.
In any case, I'm going to make a rather bold claim, which you can see behind me here, which is that we've had more pedagogic change in the last 10 years than in the last 1,000 years. Now, in the last 10 years, we've had a whole raft of things on top of TED here. The rise in social media. We will, over the next 5 years, see a massive rise in very sophisticated back-end software. E-learning is mostly front-end stuff at the moment. You'll see sophisticated algorithms, AI techniques coming into play, which are personalized, as Ken Robinson said, to your learning, what you've learned before, where you're going.
Veel technologischer zijn en met een tijd zal de cursus wel wegvallen, denk ik. Het zal allemaal wel digitaal worden gebeurd en zo. Het kan alleen maar beter worden.
Ik denk dat er veel meer gaat ingespeeld worden op technologie en ook dat er
scholen bestaan. Want de digitale weg en de manier waarop studenten vandaag informeel leren, ook leerlingen, dat is iets wat alleen maar gaat toenemen.
Brilliant teaching, simply recorded. Many of them just a few minutes long, exactly what the students need. And what he's done is he's flipped the classroom. He says, and he's right, that kids should not be given difficult problems as homework. They should be doing the exposition at home. And teachers in the classroom should be giving them formative feedback.
Blijkbaar verwerven we veel oppervlakkiger informatie. We lezen stukjes krant, we hebben korte gesprekjes, tweets, korte berichtjes. Je gaat al die dingen bij elkaar sprokkelen. Maar toch, op een of andere manier, leer je ook echt dieper dan gewoon al die oppervlakkige dingetjes bij elkaar. Je maakt als het ware een soort van verbinding tussen. En op een bepaald moment ontstaat er een soort van inzicht dat je iets begrepen hebt of dat je snapt hoe iets in elkaar zit.
It really gives the teacher real-time data as they're going through these programs. And we're able to use this data to differentiate the instruction for these kids. We're able to use this data to see their progress in real time. So it's my time to sit down with them and walk through the struggles that they're having.
Als bijvoorbeeld een leerling op een tablet of op een computer bezig is, dan kan je monitoren waar die mee bezig is en kan je die data analyseren om te weten wie heeft er hulp nodig. In feite kunnen we, als we een beetje slim zijn, veel testen gewoon weggooien. Omdat we kunnen volgen wat iemand doet terwijl hij leert.
USP is een unique selling position. Dit is de unique selling position van de school. Namelijk, het is een plaats waar je mensen echt ontmoet en waar je iets kan bijleren.
One of the roles of education is to awaken and develop these powers of creativity. You change the conditions, give people a different sense of possibility, a different set of expectations, a broader range of opportunities. You cherish and value the relationships between teachers and learners. You offer people the discretion to be creative and to innovate in what they do.
Samenwerken is in Vlaanderen geen dominante werkvorm. Terwijl als ik jou de onderzoeksresultaten tonen, zijn die onomstotelijk superieur aan individueel leren. Alleen moet je het organiseren, moet je daar structuur aan geven.
We find that there is a very participatory culture. It calls for a lot of collaboration. They no longer become just a consumer of knowledge. They actually produce knowledge.
My contention is that creativity now is as important in education as literacy. And we should treat it with the same status. In fact, creativity, which I define as the process of having original ideas that have value, more often than not, comes about through the interaction of different disciplinary ways of seeing things.
Ik denk dat opleidingen meer en meer gaan samenwerken, dat studenten navigeren tussen opleidingen heen. We gaan meer met werkveld, experten, studenten, docenten, complexe vraagstukken gaan oplossen.
Ook meer en meer samenwerking, ook bijvoorbeeld met stageplaatsen of stagemensen.
Ik zou meer creatieve projecten doen.
Wij leven van creativiteit. Wij moeten ons mensen, die moeten om de 6 maanden, moeten onze mensen zorgen voor nieuwe collecties en die moeten dus de mensen verleiden. Dus wij willen absoluut hebben, wij trekken mensen aan die talent hebben om dingen te creëren en ik ben echt overtuigd dat iedereen talent heeft.
Ja, wij doen ook een project op, een duurzaamheidsproject en we denken eventueel om overal tegels te vervangen die energie opwekken. We bestaan van TileGen. En in 10 jaar zou dat dan moeten zorgen, aangezien dat er toch zeer veel studenten rondlopen in scholen, aan de trappen, inkomen, kantine. Dat dat toch zou kunnen zorgen voor een enorme energieopwekking en zo eigenlijk verlichting, verwarming, computers, noem maar op. En dat zo eigenlijk scholen bijna volledig zelfvoorzienend zouden zijn. En dat is toch een belangrijke doelstelling voor de toekomst.
Participatief, dus vertrekkend van de student. Zowel inhoudelijk vertrekkend van de student, van wat wil een student graag leren, als methodologisch, op welke manier wil hij of zij dat doen.
And I've talked about 4 major criteria for success in network learning, specifically openness, autonomy, diversity, and interactiveness or connectedness. Networks that have these criteria make better decisions, are more reliable for use for predicting the future or determining a course of action than networks that aren't.
Misschien zal het duidelijk zelfs niet liggen op diploma's, maar wel op specialisme in het algemeen.
De eerste betoog is eigenlijk over diploma-vrij onderwijs. Voilà. Ik pleit voor diploma-vrij onderwijs. Het is diploma's die ons er niks om doen. Het feit dat wij moeten studeren waar we niet gaan studeren en niet onze passie en talenten mogen ontwikkelen. Wij moeten durven kiezen voor passie en talenten, heel modulair onderwijs, met zeer gepassioneerde leerkrachten, afschaffing van de leerplicht, levenslang leren.
scholen open-minded zullen zijn, met oog voor het ontwikkelen van de sociale vaardigheden.
En ik denk dat dat het primaire punt is waar we moeten op werken. Namelijk eigenwaarde, zelfwaarde, terug geloven in jezelf, je stuk sterk voelen en van daaruit ook keuzes kunnen maken waarmee je ook een stuk verder kan komen.
En dan merk je dat jongeren makkelijker te mobiliseren zijn voor goed doel. En dat is eigen voor deze generatie. En jongeren doen meer vrijwilligerswerk dan vroeger. En meer dan volwassenen. Eén detail, kortere periodes. Het moet inplanbaar zijn. Maar ze doen het wel.
Ik geloof in het voorstuderen en het blijven vormen dat enorm belangrijk is.
Breek uit uw grenzen. Treed uit uw comfortzone. Neem risico's. Ga naar het buitenland. Zoek contact met andere culturen.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our Festival of Innovation in Education. It is my privilege to announce Stephen Downes from the National Research Council of Canada, where he is program leader of learning and performance support systems. Beforehand, he was an information architect at the University of Alberta and a distance education and new media design specialist, so someone who is an expert in his field. He published on the role of open educational resources, innovation, and homeschooling, and today he is going to talk to us about what is innovation in education. As you have noticed, we have started a little bit late. Technology is very important. We prepared everything, but we still had to look through a few hiccups. Very important to know, or very nice to know, this session is also live streamed on the internet, so we are taking advantage of all the possible technological means for this lecture. Stephen, you have the floor.
Thanks. So hello, everyone. So that was the first time I've seen that video, so it was interesting. I find I don't know at all, so I want to be very clear about that. I came in here and I broke things. I do that a lot. So, the talk is called What is Innovation in Education? And as was mentioned in the introduction, we're streaming the talk. I wanted to do some innovating in education while I was talking about innovation in education. That's not always a wise idea, but it's fun. So, I'm doing it anyways. So, because it's streaming, fair warning, don't say anything that you might regret later, because it's being broadcast over the internet. It might be being, is it being recorded as well? Okay, and I should remember, I always forget to do things. And I forgot to turn on my audio recording. I know that you're recording it here and I don't have to turn on the audio recording, but I've learned from experience, turn on the audio recording, because sometimes the recording that they do doesn't always work. So, sometimes my audio recording doesn't always work. Oh, there we go. All right, so my audio recording is now working, so there will be a permanent record on my website of anything you say. So those of you listening to the audio recording and not viewing me in person, this is a talk titled, What is Innovation in Education? My name is Stephen Downes. It is March 30th, 2015, and I'm presenting in Ghent, Belgium, which is my first time here. And it's a lovely city, as you can see on the slide, but I guess you guys already knew that. But it was a discovery for me. So let me set up the preliminaries. It's not going to be easy, is it? No, it isn't. There we go. There's a little lag and everything. So the preliminaries are this. We are live streaming. I've also set up what is known as a back channel. This is the back channel over here. And I'll make it a bit easier to see in a few moments. But what you can do as I present this talk is you can comment. And you comment using the back channel. And also, we don't know, because it's pretty early in the morning here, so I don't know how many people we'll have online out there in the world, but we might have some. They can also comment on the back channel. Now, if this were a talk slightly later in the day, we might have a much larger group of people online. Also, too, if you had, like, Donald Clark doing this or some other presenter who's famous, you might have more people. But we'll make do with what we have. So to use the back channel, there are two ways you can do it. One is to simply use Twitter. If you have a Twitter account, if you have your mobile phone, if there's connectivity in the room, you can tweet, and anything you tweet using the hashtag Ghent2015 will show up here. Or if you do not have a Twitter account, or you prefer to comment anonymously, or if you prefer not to broadcast your comments all over Twitter, which is what I generally fall in a case like that, you can use the form that I've created for you. So you go to www.downs.ca/chat, very easy URL, and if you go there, you will see, I was just going to go there, so let's go there. You'll see a simple screen. And it looks like that. It's the one on the left there. And if you scroll down, you'll only see the one link. What is innovation in education? Active. Click on that link, and that takes you into the back channel. You'll have a screen that looks a bit like this with the current channel content and then a space for you to type in your comment. You can select a name for yourself, whatever you want. I don't mind if it's anonymous. I can take it. And type your comment in. You do not need to use the hashtag here. This system automatically recognizes that you're using the back channel. And that's all there is to it. Anything you type in will show up here. If you know HTML, HTML works, which means you can put in links, pictures, animated GIFs, cats, whatever. Yes, I know I'm living dangerously in doing this. I've done this a few times, but it's fun, and I like doing this. So we'll try it, and we'll see how it goes. It might crash completely. That's the risk that I take. A lot of people do back channels just with Twitter, and then they use TweetDeck or something like that. I prefer to use my own software because, in theory at least, I can control the way the output looks. I can have multiple ways of using the system so that you don't have to use Twitter. Because I hate requiring that you must use Twitter because they're a big company. They don't need the extra advertising. I want to make it work with Facebook and Google Plus and all the rest of them too. So I'm going to now attempt to just make it display. There. So now, in theory, new messages should show up fairly soon. In practice, not so much. So there we go. So, just testing to see if I could use this during my own courses. Actually, you can. It's on my website. And remind me not to leave my phone when I leave today. Actually, maybe I'll put that in my bag so I don't leave my phone in Ghent. So, yeah, it's free and open. Anybody can use it. You just need to access it on my system, and it does work. In practice, most people in the world have not used it. Most people don't use it. I don't know why. It's because it works fine, but anyhow. Okay. Also, for your assistance, slides are also available. And let's see if this works. Oh, they've got it all very carefully set up, don't they? I'm afraid to click the button. I mean, I might never get it back. but if you go to downs.ca/presentation/359, you'll see the instructions, and you'll see the slides for this talk, so you can skip ahead if you want. I know a lot of instructors hate allowing people to skip ahead, but again, I like to live dangerously. So that's the preliminaries. While I'm talking, do feel free to raise comments either in the back channel, or if you want to speak out loud, that's fine too. Speak very loudly if you do, because of course, they might not hear you on the recording. Okay, how's all that sound so far? I think like a little innovation. It's a little innovation. It's not a lot of innovation. You might ask, why did I do this? And it was very funny, and I hope they don't mind me quoting the response that I got, because I described what I wanted to do, the video streaming and the comments, and the response I got back was, everyone who will want to see your presentation will already be in the room. And I thought, that's a very odd response. Because, and now that I see the setup where there's, people in the other rooms, and so Donald Clark's over there, etc., I sort of see the significance of the remark, but right as well. So, again, I'm not sure how successful we will be in engaging the rest of the world, but I wanted it to be possible so that if they wanted to engage in that way, they could. And over time, learning generally becomes like that. It becomes less and less place-based, less and less environment-based, and more something that is both in person and online, and you almost can't really draw the distinction between the two. Is this an in-person talk, or is this an online talk? The distinction no longer makes sense, and that's an interesting observation to me. All right. Oh, that's all the preliminaries. On to the real talk. So, and there's always a delay. I wait, and no. There we go. Okay. So, the talk is about innovation, and I haven't actually given this talk before, so I'm not as rehearsed as I would like to be, but that's okay. And we have different intuitions about what innovation is. And if you think about it for a while, and maybe even type some of your intuitions about what you think innovation is into the back channel. You see, I'm trying to get participation going. Right? So sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But there's an emphasis on the newness. That's an intuition, right? There's an emphasis on innovation being the result of inquisitiveness or curiosity or trying to find out how things work. There's this aspect of inventiveness, of creating new things. A lot of time, innovation is grounded in what it already exists today. So when you look at the concept of innovation, you think about expanding something, growing something, building on something, combining things. And then there's the new, right? But it's supposed to be something that isn't the same as it was. I think that kind of captures innovation, but it kind of does not capture innovation. And I think the ways in which it does not capture innovation, those ways are more important than the way it does capture innovation. I'm going to have to learn to plan way ahead when I do these slides, because really, I click and it's going to be, okay. So that time it was fast. So I am here because I have been, quote unquote, innovative in the past. And a lot of the work that I do echoes around these three themes. The three themes are connectivism, open online learning, and personal learning. Connectivism, that name for the theory, of course, was given by George Siemens. It's a theory about learning networks. It's a theory that says knowledge is composed of or consists in the structure of a network. In other words, connections between a large number of distinct entities. We can think of a neural network as an example of that. A neural network, or our brain, is composed of many distinct neurons which are connected to each other. And the knowledge we have is literally that set of connections. There was once, in fact, an example where they had a mouse. They froze the mouse in such a way as to preserve the connections. Otherwise, the mouse was effectively dead, it being frozen. And it was, you know, like quick flash frozen. Anyhow, they thawed the mouse in such a way as to preserve the connections, and the mouse had all the knowledge it had had previously because the connections had been preserved. So learning, then, on a theory like connectivism, learning becomes the creation of and the navigation between these connections. Now, when this was being talked about in 2004, 2003, I called it learning networks, and I love the name because it implies a network that learns, and it implies using networks in order to learn. So there were two aspects to it, right? The first aspect was, what is learning? Well, it's the creation and formation of these connections in a network. But there was also the idea that we could use the network in order to learn. I wrote something in 2003 called E-Learning 2.0, and the idea here was that we would use social networks, connections between people, in order to create networks out in the world, and that these networks out in the world would learn in the same way as the networks in our head. The other thing about learning networks is the aspect, or the way that networks themselves learn. What are the conditions that cause a connection to form between two entities, between two neurons, between two people, between two crows, between two crickets, between two anything? What are the conditions? And that question and that investigation becomes the theory of connectivism and the basis for a lot of the technology that follows. A major piece of that technology was open online learning, or the massive open online course. And just to counter a bit of the video, George and I invented the massive open online course in 2008. It was an innovation. The question is, why was it an innovation? Even more significantly, when we invented it in 2008, was it yet an innovation? Or did it have to wait until 2011 when Thrund and Norvig created the Stanford AI course? We attracted about 2,200 for our first massive open online course. They attracted something like 150,000 people. Complete difference in scale. Our course was called Massive. Theirs was very massive. The third theme that runs through a lot of my work is a natural outgrowth from both of those two themes, and that's personal learning, and that's the project that I'm working on now. In the introduction, it was mentioned that I'm the program leader for Learning and Performance Support Systems. That's a name that only a business representative could write. In other words, I did not create that name, but it's a way of presenting a concept that we call personal learning environments. And the idea of a personal learning environment is to give an individual, a student perhaps, a teacher perhaps, a person generally, a mechanism for connecting with other people. The MOOC that George and I built was very different from the MOOC that were built subsequently by, you know, Norvig, Thrun, and others. Very different from the MOOCs of Udacity, very different from the MOOCs of Coursera, in that our MOOCs were set up as a network. Our MOOCs were set up so that they functioned by means of forming and reforming connections between people, and connections between ideas, and connections between services. And the personal learning environment that we're developing in LPSS, terrible name, is a mechanism that allows an individual to form these many connections. This technology that I'm attempting to display here, and that seems to be working to some degree, is again an attempt to create a connection between ourselves and other people in the world, a connection between you with each other in the audience as I speak, so that it's not all just me speaking to you, a connection between you in this audience and people out there in the world, maybe, who might be listening, although right now it's 4:30 Twitter, or you read their blogs and so on. People are coming up with these ideas every single day. There's no idea that you can possibly have, I think, that somebody has not already thought of it. And I always have my standard disclaimer for talks that I give, right? Everything I say, everything I propose, etc., somebody else has already come up with it. So given that everything I'm telling you here now is a retread, a repeat, what is innovative about it? Seemingly nothing. And yet, I'm here, and they're not. I think that's an interesting phenomenon. So, what is innovation? I stole this from just the dictionary definition. If you type into Google, Google helpfully defines the word for you, because Google is the arbitrator of all things. So the action or process of innovating a new method, idea, product, etc., and then it gives me a whole bunch of synonyms, and these synonyms all pretty much kind of match. You're looking for a GPS. That's interesting. I am the GPS of connectors. No. So I find it interesting that they've hashtagged GPS. Anyhow. So now we're going to get a whole bunch of mappies. Never mind. So change, alteration, revolution, upheaval, transformation. Everybody thinks of Clay Christensen, right, when we talk about innovation, disruptive innovation and all. I also promised myself I was not going to use the word disruptive in this talk, but that's beside the point. Novelty, newness, creativity, originality, etc. But if you look a few links down in Google, which I know nobody does because you always take the top link, there's another perspective. This one is from what's called the Business Dictionary. The process of translating an idea or invention into a good or service, okay, so far so good, that creates value or for which customers will pay. Now, that's kind of different from what I've been talking about so far, right? That's different from newness, creativity, etc. To be called an innovation, it continues, an idea must be replicable at an economical cost and must satisfy a specific need. Now, I'm the last person, believe me, the last person to walk into a room and start quoting from the Business Dictionary in order to define a concept. Believe it, and count on it, that will never happen again. But it does capture the idea that in order for something to be an innovation, It has to be more than just new. It has to be more than just creative. It has to exist, and it has to serve an actual need. And, you know, the business people are weird because they always talk about money. And so, you know, a lot of the time when they talk about whether something is worth anything, they talk about, well, what will people pay for it? I've learned a lot recently about that mindset because I'm doing this program leader thing, so I have to do budgets and things like that. What I'm coming to understand, and I think I've always understood it, is that the mindset is that money, or specifically willingness to pay, is used by them as a proxy for value. And to a certain significantly large subset, it's actually an equivalent, right? Value equals willingness to pay, or value equals cost of something. I really don't go for that. But there's another aspect of this that's important, and that is value as defined by or determined by benefits. So if we put these concepts together, the concept of an innovation means that we're creating something new, innovative, creative, et cetera, that drives value, which means that it produces benefits of some kind. You can't just do any old thing and call it an innovation. It has to produce a benefit. Well, what is a benefit? That really is in the eye of the beholder. I'm planning ahead here. Not nearly enough. So this is a fancy picture. I like it, and the link is there. And I know you can't read that text, so that's why I gave you the link to the slides so that you can go read it on your own if you want to do that. MOOCs should be set up as a network, yes. But here's the idea of what's going on in that diagram. It will go. There we go. I've never seen a computer take so long to advance a slide. So think about what and the phrase is, what the drivers are for innovation. And they really break down into two categories. What causes or creates an innovation, which is mostly what you'll read about in the business press, etc. And on the other hand, the need or the pull for an innovation. So the drivers, the push drivers, when people talk to you about technology, and you know, if you've been sold a learning management system, or if you've been sold, I don't know, something to put in your classroom, they generally talk about the push kind of things. Right? They talk about price. They talk about digital technologies and how this is cool. It's just punted me from the system. So somebody will have to log in for me again. So they talk about security. Social media, globalization, change. You've probably heard all of these drivers for this, that, or the other technology. Security is a big one these days. And everybody's, you know, they want, our software must be secure now. Our Wi-Fi must be secure. And sometimes so secure that nobody can use it. I also cannot use my email here, because my email is secure, and my security conflicts or clashes with their security. So to know if something is innovative is maybe much more difficult than seeing what has been innovative. I'm reading from one of the comments in the back channel. That's a really interesting observation. Oops. I'm just getting this up onto a nice, there we go. So, and in theory, that should be innovative. We almost never talked about cost. Yeah, well, was a car cheaper than a horse? I don't know if it's ever been cheaper than a horse. I don't know. I don't know how much horses cost. That's an interesting question. Certainly an airplane has never been cheaper than a horse. And we, you know, and actually when we think about airplanes, cost isn't really the sort of thing that we have in mind. We want it to get us from here to there successfully. Because failure in an airplane is generally not an option. Digital technology. Does it matter to you if your airplane has digital technology? When you book a ticket on an airline, did you do it because, you know, the advertisement for Lufthansa said, our airplanes have digital technology? No, not really. It's interesting to look at advertisements that focus on what something is in the sense or in the frame of being innovative. They're trying to capture the pull aspect. They're trying to capture the things that you need. You need, says the advertisement, to spend a week in the Canary Islands. You need to travel to North America or whatever. They try not to say need, but they try to imply need, right? It's interesting. So there's the separation between the push kind of drivers, which people say are compelling us toward innovation. You probably, I'm sure, have seen the talk and then seen the reaction about the relentless push of technology, right? And people don't ask, and they should ask, why has technology been so relentless, right? It's, you know, and we see, and Jay Cross even has on his wall the picture of the wave, right? The great big tsunami wave of technology, and for that matter, globalization and market forces and all of that that are washing over us. Why do these things exist, right? Because technology and globalization and all of that aren't these, or social media and the rest of it, aren't these inevitable forces that come and overwhelm us, even though it feels that way. They come because they are innovations, and they are innovations because they are serving a need. Why is technology overwhelming us? Because it lets us do stuff that we could not do before. I've picked a few of the polls here. You'll have to think about that for yourself. Growth, people talk about economic growth. I don't really think that's the purpose of learning, but personal growth certainly is. Personal development, advancing personal capacities. Sustainability is certainly a pull for digital technology, certainly a pull for online learning especially. We learned that when the price of fuel became very expensive and flying became very expensive and all of a sudden people were doing online courses all over the place, the arrival of the MOOC, the massive open online course, was coincidental, but maybe not so coincidentally, at the same time as the dramatic rise in the price of fuel and the dramatic increase in the cost of attending courses and attending programs, etc. People wanted what MOOCs offered. What they wanted was personal development, but in a sustainable way. So you might think, and maybe even computer speaks Limburgs and takes a siesta, that must be a localism. Limburgs means speech very slow. Oh, okay. Do the Limburgers know you think like this? It's okay. All right. They have clever minds, but just not so fast. Okay. So think about that. Think about, you know, Why are you in this room? Why do you have a phone? Why do you have a computer? Is this just this thing that happened to you? No. Each one of you made a decision to get a phone, to get a computer, to be in this room, to still be in this room. It's in one way or another your choice. And it's your choice, and you're here, and you're using these technologies because it is serving some kind of need or benefit. So there's this whole model. I've called it the benefits model, but it's probably a misnomer. It's probably not really called the benefits model, but that's how I think of it in my own mind. It's a way to separate out in my head the aspect of thinking about benefits, which is distinct from the push of technology or globalism or other, and also to keep it distinct from this idea of, oh, value must mean people will pay for it, because that's an absurd and ridiculous notion. So in the analysis of a concept, an idea, a proposal, in the determination of whether it is an innovation, we look at different aspects of it. And that's what this model tries to capture. It's a very common model in business press. If you're studying an MBA, you'll probably see this like the first day of classes. So, and again, nothing new here under the sun. This is an old model that other people have written about that I'm just talking about. So typically, the recognition of a benefit comes with the identification of a problem. And they keep repeating this over and over, so I'll repeat it. What is it that keeps you up at night? Right. Now, nothing keeps me up at night because I've taken heavy sedatives. No, I'm kidding. but the idea is, you know, the problem is identified by the fact that people worry about it. This is really important to define it this way because it doesn't mean it has to be a real problem. And indeed, there's a very large segment of business and commerce that is all about manufacturing or creating a need. And if you read Chomsky, and if you haven't, you should, the whole concept of manufacturing consent is around this idea of creating a need for something, creating or identifying some kind of benefit. So a benefit is a psychological thing, right? I see you going like that because the second thing that they talk in these classes is the distinction between needs and wants. And a need is supposedly an objective thing that you can't live without, and a want is a nice to have. So there is this thinking out there in the world that a benefit is something tangible, something objective, and the whole idea is just to get you to recognize it. And maybe, maybe not. But the main point, I'll stick with saying a benefit is psychological, that the problem does not actually need to exist in order for there to be a solution to it. The classic case, of course, is the invasion of Iraq, where the problem did not actually exist, but they did it anyways. So you break that down. You have the objective of solving the problem. You have the success factors, which tell you whether you're trying to show that. Sorry, you need to be able to show that you have in fact solved the problem that you're trying to solve. And this is where all these, you know, the measurements and milestones and indicators and all of that come in, is an effort to quantify or measure the way you've solved that problem. But the essential thing here isn't the measurement. The essential thing is knowing that your innovation actually addresses a need. The rest of it rolls out into the, you know, does your solution actually scale? Does it actually solve the problem for more than one person? Does it solve the problem on a large scale with massive numbers of people? And in the end, does it provide what we might call a measurable benefit And the benefit is distinct from the resolution of the problem. The benefit is the overall, I don't want to use the word upside because that's terrible, but the overall net improvement to the body of users, typically society as a whole, that result from your innovation. Your innovation can solve a problem, but the consequence of solving that problem might be too great to bear. It's like, you know, curing cancer with cyanide. It'll work. It really will. You will cure the cancer with cyanide. You will, unfortunately, kill the person you're curing. So the benefit is you not only cure the cancer, you also do not kill the person. You need to look at it in the aggregate. And, you know, it's with some kinds of these cancer cures, they work on one person, and then the guy goes on TV. This worked. It cured this person's cancer. The problem is that's the only person that treatment will ever help. Right? You need to be able to show this wider, more widespread benefit from the innovation. You might wonder why I'm talking about all of this, because I'm talking about technology. But let's go back to massive open online learning for a second, for example. What were the benefits? What problems were MOOCs solving? And I ask it that way because on the one hand, we have the MOOCs that are set up as networks to create a network that learns, a society that learns, a person that learns. On the other hand, we have things like the Norvig and Thrun MOOCs, which are really, you know, videos and presentations and maybe some, you know, you work on your computer a bit, we saw in the video. They're clearly solving different problems because the technologies are very different. I'm trying to create networks of people. They're trying to broadcast information. Two very different things. I think that what I did was innovative, and what they did is not innovative. Not because what I did is new and what they did is not, but because what I did creates a benefit, makes learning more effective and even more to the point, more accessible and more sustainable. What they did is attempt to replicate an existing model of learning in such a way that they can make money from it. Two different objectives. Which is why in the video, one of the main things it said is, you may recall, they still have not found a way of making these things sustainable yet. They still have not found a business model for it. The business model is defined in terms of how they make money from it rather than how it solves a problem. And I think that's really significant. So this is a chart that I stole from a site called Education for Opportunity. And I like it because it breaks out now the different aspects of defining these benefits. And so basically what they have here is what might be called a workflow. Sometimes it's also thought of as a value chain. I don't like that for a bunch of reasons. But it's the basically four major steps in the development and deployment of an innovation. And it's hard to read this, but it goes from finance to process to offering to delivery. And then I've added a fifth because I think in our field we're also looking for impact. And impact is distinct from any of those first four things. So this model is very much rooted in the product and the value and the benefits of the product. In education, though, if we look at what we deliver, the product is very different from the thing that we're trying to achieve in the end. Even if we think of the product, quote unquote, as an educated student, which is really a horrible way to think of it. Really, the reason why we're doing that is to create benefits for a wider society. And again, think about... be careful, Rosemary. if you think about it, why are we doing this whole education thing to begin with? Why are we educators? And I don't mean just because, you know, in the sense of, well, I need to make a salary because I have two young children to raise, although that is the reason why many people are educators, because they pay you money, and that's a perfectly valid reason. But the other side of it, why do they pay you money, even? Why does society as a whole value education? It's not just because they want to produce people who know things, but rather there are wider benefits, wider impacts to society that are caused by education that we're attempting to create. And this is one of the things that reformers of education do not always recognize, that they do not see the need for the impact that is created by education. What's the sort of impact? Well, I talk about things like lower crime rates. An educated population will be less of a criminal population because they have more alternatives. So that's one result. Better health. An educated population will have better health than an uneducated population for a variety of reasons that we can speculate about. More stability. We can all hear that message. So it's probably going to show up on the transcript. Because it's funny because on a system like this, it picks up the volume and amplifies it. So I get that result with Skype all the time. It's one of the unexpected benefits of Skype is that you can listen in on phone conversations, the other side of the phone conversation, because Skype will pick up any noise it can find and amplify it. That can be, if the other person has a TV on, that can be really bad because the TV then also gets amplified. Anyhow, so when I think about technology, when I think about the MOOC and personal learning and things like that, I'm typically not thinking about the product. I'm not thinking about even the offering. I'm not even thinking about the delivery. I'm thinking about the impact. And I'm typically always working back. It's a Dell. So let's look at some of the innovations that have happened in schooling recently, or maybe they're innovations, maybe they're not innovations. Can tutoring for math lower crime rates? Yeah, very good. Is that a real study? Excellent. What did they conclude? It does. See, I wasn't making it up. Well, okay, I was making it. No, I wasn't, really. It's actually fairly well known. Tutoring for math, lore, I like that, though, that there's actually a study that proves that. So that means that tutoring for math is obtaining the kind of impact of education that we're looking for. I wonder if that shows up in their test scores. Oh, never mind. I'm going to break down the innovations in education into three major categories. The first is economy, the next is technology, and the last is pedagogy. I probably should have done these in reverse order, but I didn't really think of the reverse order thing until I was talking about that slide, so sometimes you have to adapt on the fly. So, and I'm not making the claim, very importantly, that these are all innovations. In fact, I'm going to leave that for you to determine whether or not they are innovations. I do it that way because, again, benefits really are in many ways a psychological phenomenon. They're certainly not the sort of phenomenon that I can come up with and say, here's a benefit. Everybody, you'll see that this is a benefit. So let's look at this. You know, one of the major changes that have been produced in education in recent years is charter schooling. Charter schooling is the idea that you get a collection of parents or other stakeholders together who define what a school should be and draft that in a charter, and then they use that charter in order to seek and obtain funding from a government school, a government source, or a school board. The interesting about charter schooling is that it's one of the major mechanisms by which the provision of schooling is shifted from a public system to a private system, a system shifting from a system whereby people who work in schools work for the government or school boards or some other public entity, and instead work for a company or some entity that's providing the charter schools. It's interesting because although ostensibly charter schools are supposed to be community-based and created by, you know, interested parties, specifically parents, companies have formed in order to organize these parent groups in order to create charter schools, which they will then manage. So charter schools becomes a mechanism for the privatization of education without necessarily preserving the stakeholder or parental impact that it was intended to have. So the question is this an innovation? Depends on what you need, right? Depends on what your benefits are. Certainly from the perspective of companies who wish to be able to gain access to the market and the money paid for education, charter schools are an innovation because it's a new way for them to get access to that market. For parents who are seeking to have their children learn things or learn in a way distinct from what is offered by the public system, it has the potential of being an innovation. They often use the phrase school choice when they're talking about charter schools. They're talking about choice in subject matter, choice in delivery method, choice in pedagogy, etc. But the question here becomes, are charter schools actually providing that benefit? See, it's one thing, again, to talk about the benefit, but then you have to look at what the schools do and ask if they've resulted in that benefit. Although I will make an aside, one of the criticisms of charter schools is that they do not produce increases in test scores. Fair enough. Let's suppose that they do not. I think that's probably true. Is that actually a criticism of charter schools from the perspective of the benefits they were intended to produce? The benefits they were intended to produce was a privatization of education. That has nothing to do with test scores. So it's and I'm no, I'll say this very clearly too, I am not a fan of charter schools. But in order to criticize charter schools, we need to understand why they were created and what purpose they were intended to satisfy. It's a very common thing to criticize something because it does not satisfy a certain set of criteria or produce a certain set of benefits when that thing was never intended to produce those benefits in the first place. I go back to MOOCs again. MOOCs, one of the major criticisms of MOOCs is people drop out. Another major criticism of MOOCs is people do not receive a certificate. I respond to those criticisms by saying that was never the intended benefit. We were not trying to produce a system that kept everybody in the room. In fact, one of the benefits of MOOCs, from my perspective, is that people can drop out because they can get into the MOOC for free, a minimal investment of time, so that when they drop out, as many of them do, they are not suffering a significant economic loss. That's a different kind of benefit. Similarly, the certification, right? they say, well, MOOCs don't provide certification. Well, we never intended to, because the result that we're trying to create here is the creation of a learning community. And a certificate does not recognize that. The certificate recognizes the individual amassing of a certain amount of knowledge. We don't even know what the knowledge is ahead of time in a MOOC that's created as a network. That's, again, distinct from the other kind of MOOCs where it's defined as a subject and you have a certain body of content that must be taught and remembered. In their case, certification and test scores matter. In our case, we're not trying to get them to learn a certain body of content. So certification and test scores are meaningless. We're going for a different result. Learning marketplace, again, another kind of privatization of learning, if you will. Privatization in the sense of, instead of purchasing learning materials from a single sole source, like, say, the university bookstore, there's a marketplace of many different locations where you can purchase materials. Is that an innovation? Certainly, the idea of a marketplace is not an innovation, at least not recently. Is it an innovation to apply that concept to education? Well, that's a good question. It's not one I'm going to answer. It's one that you'll have to answer for yourself. Would it make sense for there to be a marketplace of learning resources as compared to whatever you have now? Would it make sense to have a marketplace of schools? Well, we actually almost kind of have that, don't we? People can choose whatever, you know, certainly at the college and university level, they can choose whatever school that they want to go to. When they're younger, there's less of a choice. It's different in every society, and I don't know how much choice there is in Belgium for picking schools. Is there choice? Okay, so there already is a marketplace of schools. Are they all offered by the state, or is it a mixture of state and private? State and private. State and private, okay. How's that work?
It's organized by four champions.
Organized by?
Four types of organizations.
Okay.
Also in the private, you have three players, and governmental is only
one player. Okay. So there's a wide variety of producers, a wide variety of funding models, and I assume, therefore, a wide variety of different subjects or areas of concentration. In Edmonton in Canada, it's provided by the city, or well, not the city, but by the school boards, and they also have a wide variety of choices. And so there's a school that focuses on dance. There's a school that focuses on hockey because it's Canada. There's a school specifically for inner city youth that don't necessarily have parents. There's a typical large suburban high school. There's a wide range of schools. Open learning is another one of these economic innovations, and there's different interpretations as to what open learning means, but the way it's typically used in the sense of, for example, the Open University, it's access to a learning system without necessarily having prior credentials. So open learning typically means open access, but not necessarily free access. Athabasca University in Canada was founded under the same sort of principle. And it's an innovation because previous to that, at least for the decades previous to that, in order to gain admission to a college or a university, you had to present previously acquired credentials. Now you don't have to do that. You just have to give them money. There's another way of looking at open learning, and it's the way that I prefer, where even the provision of money is not required. In order to access learning, all you need to do is access the learning. So you still need to invest time. If it's online learning, you still need to invest in internet access. We have had charter schools for decades in Belgium. If you look at how education is organized, with a lot of freedom, seldom used. Interesting. So, is open learning an innovation? Is learning without charging people money for it an innovation? I think that's an interesting question. And so, and now it goes right away. I wish I could predict. if it's okay if it's always going to take 10 seconds to switch slides, but it's the variability. Innovation in technology is something that has actually received most of the attention in recent decades. The whole concept of online learning, digital learning, etc., seems to be focused on this, although I find it very interesting. In North America, at least, a lot of people view the technology as the lever which will be used to implement the economic model. And so for that reason, there's a lot of criticism of technology because people think of using technology in schools as equivalent to the privatization of schools. And they view the privatization of schools as equivalent to the removal of unions that protect teachers. So technology becomes bad because from the teacher's point of view, it means they'll lose their job. It's interesting because that, I'm pretty sure, was never the intent of any of these innovations. Although, arguably, that's the consequence. So it raises or begs the question as to whether these are really innovations in the sense of providing a net benefit overall. But the learning management system is one that came out in the mid to late 1990s, and it's probably one that you're all very familiar with. It's a mechanism for managing your class, your students, your grade books, for submission of grades, for providing people a place to put their stuff, etc. Learning objects came out in the late 1990s, and by now you might have all forgotten what they were, because it's one of these things that came, it was popular for a while, and then it disappeared. But the idea of a learning object was that it would be a digital object, typically small, that could be plugged into a learning management system as a reusable piece of learning content. And so the objectives, the benefit that learning objects were intended to provide was reusability and discoverability. So you could find the things in the first place and then you could reuse them in one course or another course or another course so that you would not have to produce the same sort of learning materials over and over again. Now, it's interesting because these were widely touted as an innovation, yet how many of you use learning objects today? Nobody. Nobody in the room. How many of you even know what they are? One person? That's interesting because in the last few years of the 1990s, the first few years of the 2000s, virtually all activity in learning technology was devoted to the development and deployment of learning objects. And now, nothing. Were they innovative? It's an interesting question. Certainly at the time, they were touted as innovative. The question of whether they were innovative, though, is did we actually need discoverability and reusability of learning resources? And because, no question, that's what learning objects provided, were those two things. They were specifically designed for that. I ask that now in this context because there are other innovations coming down the pipe which do pretty much the same sort of thing. There was the IMS Common cartridge of a few years ago that's trying to do that. Let me ask of all of you, do you feel a need for discoverability and reusability of learning resources. I'm seeing some nods. But only a few. Okay, I'll poll you then, because I can do that. How many of you believe that you do need discoverability and reusability? One, two, a scattering of hands. How many of you feel you do not? Even fewer. How many? Well, let's say the rest of you don't know or won't vote. It's a crisis in democracy in this room. Maybe I should become more radical. If I become more radical, that'll cause more people to respond against me. And never mind. So it's interesting, but the ambivalence around the concept is interesting. I find it fascinating because it begs the question, what are the needs or the benefits that technology is serving for you? Oh, you were intrigued by Chaos Pilot on the slides, and I skipped right by it. I'm sorry. Chaos Pilot, it's a project from Denmark, which is basically a type of self-organized learning. So, and it's based around the idea that people join the program, they organize their own learning, they do a project which has economic import, and it might be a business project, it might be a volunteer kind of project for which they receive funding, etc. But the idea is learning, where the system has various decision points. The decision points are based on input or information from the learner, and the outcome of those decisions is the presentation of this, that, or the other type of learning material. So, having said that, how many of you feel a need for that? And significantly more people. That is fascinating. Because adaptive learning is a system that depends on the discovery and reusability of learning content. And in fact, it wouldn't work without it. But you're less interested in reusability of content, but you're more interested in adaptive learning. That's fascinating. It's also especially fascinating coming from a group of teachers. So there is a need, which I don't have time or ability at this moment to pin down, there's a need for a benefit that adaptive learning might be able to deliver by people whose job it is to recognize and deliver learning resources based on outcomes from students. So it's sort of like you need the automation of your own work. Fascinating. Okay. Learning analytics is the logic behind things like adaptive learning. Learning analytics is the idea of, instead of simply sampling the output from one student, as for example in a pre-test or a post-test, you sample the output from large numbers of students, big data. And that enables you to make more fine-grained, probability-based decisions on what learning resources to recommend or what educational intervention to deliver. So the idea of learning, for example, learning analytics as used in a learning management system might be a mechanism for determining ahead of time whether or not a person is going to fail. Because in general, people who exhibit such and such a trait, for example, never showing up to class, they are more likely to fail than people who do not exhibit that trait. So that's a pretty obvious one. If they never show up to class, yeah, they're going to fail. We probably, if they don't do any of the tests, that's a pretty good sign. But what about if they don't do the readings? Does that mean they're going to fail? Well, it might depend on the class. I went through many classes where I did not do the readings, but I still got an A, which I found interesting. and surprised that that was possible. Other classes, if you don't do the readings, you're going to fail because you just cannot pass the test without having done the readings. So analytics is a mechanism for producing decisions which can be applied. The decisions are based on mass phenomena, but they can be applied in individual cases. Now, I have to ask again, how many of you feel a need for that? Fewer, substantially fewer people than were interested in adaptive learning. You people are really inconsistent. But that's the nature of benefits, right? That's why it's so hard to identify benefits, because benefits are non-rational. If benefits were rational, as we progressed through this, there would be a relation between those four sets of technologies that we could predict. But instead, it goes up and down. It's interesting. One, two, oh, this is going to be a long one. Three, four, five. Come on. There we go. I just love this. I wonder what it's running. Never mind. So, it's interesting because innovation in pedagogy, I actually didn't put constructivism up there. Oh, well. innovation in pedagogy is what very frequently captures the interest of educators and teachers, not surprisingly. And yet innovation in pedagogy is so frequently tied to innovation in technology. Adding this interesting study on personalized review to the talk. Excellent. Oh, and that's the link for it. Cool. I'll have to check that out. I've put up a few. It's interesting because when I present MOOCs to people, the reaction by commentators is, oh, they're attempting to do what Illich did with deschooling society. And I've read it now, but I did not read Illich until after coming up with many of these concepts. I wasn't going for a pedagogical change particularly. I was going for a change more in technology and economy. I was focused on access to learning, and access to learning to me was a problem that could be solved with things like open learning and network learning. And the pedagogical aspects fell out of that, if you will. There were, I don't want to say unintended consequences, but they were undesigned consequences. And for me, it was interesting, creating the MOOC, it was interesting to see that the effect of the MOOC, the consequence of the MOOC, was the different style of learning. Although it was interesting because that style of learning was what can be characterized as network learning, and it exhibited the properties of a network that learns. Social networks and learning, Twitter, Facebook, et cetera, is sometimes touted as a pedagogical innovation. I have to ask, how many of you see a need for social networks and learning? Wow, more. And what's the benefit that's produced by that? No? Maybe if someone can think of a benefit for it, you can put it into the back channel. That'll be interesting. Go ahead. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's interesting how this came out. Social networks to produce interaction to see if they've learned. Does that sound right? So the benefit, as I would analyze it here, the benefit is having a mechanism whereby students can determine for themselves whether they have learned. And the means to produce that benefit is the interaction. In theory, anything that produced that interaction would produce that benefit, in theory. In practice, maybe not. We have this mechanism for producing interaction, even using social networks. It's not clear, at least to me yet, that it shows that people have or have not learned. It probably wouldn't, just because of the way it's deployed here. So, I'm just coming to the wind-up of the talk. Progress. The development of skills, sure. Disruption. Is disruption in and of itself progress? Design. And Ghent, if I can say anything about Ghent, it's a city of design. Is design progress? That may show how little I know about Ghent. I don't know, but that's the impression I've gotten from one being here one day. If I had to characterize the city in one word, it would be design, which is interesting in and of itself. Test scores. Are increasing test scores an indicator of progress? Are they a benefit? And then, of course, career, the development of career. And next time I do this, I'll spell it correctly. What constitutes retrenchment? I view retrenchment as the opposite of progress or the opposite of innovation. And I tried to think about this, and it seems to me the focus on product, the focus on profit, the focus on traffic, the focus on margins, and the focus on austerity are all signs or symptoms of retrenchment. Innovation, to me, represents progress, represents growth. Innovation is the opposite of things that are, well, retrenchment. It's a bad way of saying it, but I can't think of another word at the moment. So, as I was doing some reading to try to frame these thoughts, I came on a post that quoted Larry Keeley, and I felt rather than try to reinvent this, I'll just go with what he said because it was pretty much what I thought about the subject. So, the way forward toward innovation, and therefore, I guess, away from retrenchment. Think big and stand in the future. And by that, what they mean is not so much thinking big and standing in the future, despite what it actually says, but rather to avoid thinking about what the situation is today. I get this a lot, where I'll talk about something and people will come back with a sentence that begins with the phrase, yes, but the reality is, right? And when somebody begins with a sentence that says, the reality is, that tells me that they're about to give me an opinion about why something can't be done. And so I try to focus not on what the reality of today is, but rather on the objective or the goal of tomorrow, and then everything becomes a transition problem. And there are always transition problems from where we are to where we want to be, but the important thing to focus on is where we want to be as opposed to why we can't get there. Second thing, prototype a compelling model solution. This is the bit about, you know, how do I want to put this? You need some way of demonstrating that what you're proposing will actually produce benefits. And it's not simply the benefit of it's digital or this wave is going to go or go over everything or, you know, it's the inevitable result of globalization. The model is intended to show what the innovation will produce. And your model will almost certainly be wrong. This is one thing I've learned about models over the years. Certainly, the model is never the reality, and it's so not the reality that what you actually produce will not produce the benefits that you thought it would. If you're lucky, it'll produce new and different benefits. But the idea of producing a model is to try to get some kind of handle on that and try to have something that other people can look at and respond to in different ways. Often, the benefits that result from a technology are the result of people using it in ways it was not designed to be used. The internet, for example, was not designed to share 1 billion cat pictures. But that's what it's used for. And that, arguably, is one of its greatest benefits. And I have a whole talk about that. I really do. And that's why you get the next one, co-construct, co-construct, co-construct. I had a long conversation last night, too long, too late, about the phenomenon of stigmergy, which is the creation, I'll get this slightly wrong, but this is the way I think of it, the creation of knowledge by working on a common object. Stigmergy is the co-building of a thing in the physical world. That's important. It was important last night because the concepts that apply to stigmergy are often applied to personal learning, but there is no co-building happening in your mind. But it does happen in society, and the reason why you want to do it is to get all of these different reactions and different ways of seeing things. The reason why you build a model, you don't just build it in your head, you build it in a public place in order to produce this stigmergic response so that other people are adding to the model too. And then that can reshape the idea that you're thinking of and be able to better anticipate some of the unexpected responses. If people, now sometimes that's a danger. If people had actually modeled the internet before they built it, they probably never would have built it. So you have to be careful about stigmergy. Imagine trying to convince the United States Department of Defense in the 1950s that we want to build a system that will be used to share 1 billion cat pictures. There's no way. It would never have happened. There's three more. So the next one, and it's interesting because I'm speaking in an institution, and in an institution there's almost always central control. Avoid central control. Back channel inactive. Okay. And the reason why you want to avoid central control, I have a whole other talk on this too, is it typically does not work. My application is also not working. There we go. Hopefully that's why it's not working. This is the result of centralized control. It's the inevitable result. And that's the problem with centralized control. It's based on the idea that the person or the unit doing the controlling can anticipate what the needs are and what the expected benefits are of a particular system. In this case, this is not the benefit that I wanted, although it's the benefit that I wanted. In a wider context, they do not produce a benefit. I'd give more examples, but we're running toward the end of time, and I can tell by the rustling in the room and the fact that some people actually left. So That's basically the talk that I wanted to give. Well, no, that's basically the talk that I gave. It wasn't exactly the talk that I wanted to give, but I did want to work through and work over these ideas in front of people. And don't you love technology? So I have two computers right now. Neither of them is working. So I think I'll close on that note, and thank you very much. I don't know what happened. I think it just advanced to
Yes. It advanced to the last slide.
Yeah, and I did not ask it to do that, it just did it.